Just keep me posted where you're at.
I bring the monitor so I can look at everything.
So undeniable, I just used one hardly speak
a second to peace, wrap that up.
So unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me.
I guess John
still as you call me.
If I get voted in, I
see the right direction that long.
Say that you're my God, you're all. Good morning, everybody. We're going to get started in about 5 minutes. If you'd please take your seats. The annual meeting will begin in 5 minutes.
Thank you.
are going to get started now for our annual meeting. If you please take your seats. Please get some goodies and take a seat as we prepare to celebrate wonderful news about all that the Holy Spirit is doing in this church. Thank you very much. We're going to begin with a prayer. And as you can see from the proposed order of service, we have a hymn, They'll Know We Are Christians, which we already offered up during the last worship service. And so instead, I'm going to begin with a special prayer entitled For a Church Convention or Meeting from the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, source of all wisdom and understanding, be present with us who take counsel for the renewal and mission of your church. Teach us in all things to seek first your honor and glory. Guide us to perceive what is right and grant us both the courage to pursue it and the grace to accomplish it through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Welcome to this annual meeting. And our first order of business is the determination of a quorum. Julie, our clerk, is our teller. Do we have a quorum? Yes, we do have a quorum. We have 99 people, and that's a quorum. Thank you very much. Okay, we begin with the approval of the 2023 minutes. Thank you, Clerk Julie Sullivan. I hope you all have had a chance to look through the minutes. And do we have a motion to approve the 2023 minutes? Second? All those in favor? All those opposed? So approved. Thank you so much. It's our joy to welcome our new members. There are too many to name for the sake of time, but you've heard the statistics that in the last year and a half we've had 40% growth. We've welcomed over 100 members plus 40 since August plus. I think even today we have to add that number up because I've seen some people today I think are new with us. So welcome. No matter when you've entered this sacred garden of God's presence, you're welcome here. We're thankful you're here. And we're glad that you are becoming members, either formally or you're on the journey toward considering this your spiritual home. We're so thankful for all that the Lord's doing here. We now move on to our election of vestry members. I want to acknowledge our exiting vestry members, including Ella Ashwell, Lon King, Mark Heyer, Tom Shoemaker, and Jeannie Dupel. Thank you for your service. Just to pause before we get to the election of new members, our new member count is 111, and we have a new member recognition, the Perez family, if they're here. Noreen and Jesse. It's a delight to see you both jumping right into service as well. I often tell people, give yourself a year as you join a church, which is, I think, good wisdom, but at the same time, after a year, get into ministry, if not before that. Because as the baptized, we all have a calling, and we help each other fulfill the hope of our calling. And it can change. And so I thank you all for the ministries you carry out. You know, we clergy, we do some very specific things. We administer the sacraments, we preach the gospel, we offer pastoral care, but we can't do what we do without you, the lady. So may your ministries continue to expand. Okay, without any further ado, now we have the election of the proposed vestry members, Bob Brown for a 2-year term as warden. Emily Keel, Casmelians, Taylor Nimmer, and Danielle Swan. Do we have any nominations from the floor? If not, may I have a motion to approve our new vestry members? Barry Stocker has moved, and who has seconded? Peter Dayton. All those in favor? Opposed? And so it passes. Welcome, new members. Welcome to the new season. Now we have exiting convention delegates, Pam Lanier, Carol McLaughlin, and Sue Riddell. Our current convention delegates are John Burson, Brent Butcher, and Cindy Eaton. And we're thankful for your service, those of you that are exiting, in terms of the role you've played in helping us stay connected to the wider diocesan family of the Episcopal Diocese of Southeast Florida, which includes going to convention and taking part in the deliberations of the church. And I'm pleased to say at the last convention, we had a significant role, and I'll say more about that in a few moments during my rector's remarks. Now we move to elect the proposed convention alternates among the delegates, Ella Ashwell, Mark Heyer, and Tom Shoemaker. May I have a motion to approve the election of these alternates? That's Bob Brown. Second. Christine Soriano is the second. All those in favor? Opposed? So moved. Thank you very much. And now it is truly our honor to welcome the Reverend Dr. Charmaine Davis. Charmaine was president of my installation, and it's a joy to have you back again. Charmaine, come on up.
Thank you very much. I won't take long. Good morning. I got a phone call, and the person on the phone said, "Shar, Shar." Whenever they say that, I know I'm going down a rabbit's hole. But Father Christian is my very good friend. And I just want to talk just a little bit about some of the things that we have done together and our congregation has done with your congregation. I am the Reverend Dr. Charmaine Davis, and I am associate minister at St. Paul AME Church, which is right over there in East Stuart. I've been a member of that church technically in my heart since I was about 9, when we first moved from Mississippi. My family moved here. And we were originally United Methodist, but there was not an African-American United Methodist church in this area, and it still is not. And so we joined the AME church. And I don't know if I have time to do a little bit of the history of the AME church. You know, many churches were founded because of difference in opinion, difference in theology. But the African Methodist Episcopal Church was founded due to social justice. The original members that were African and Caucasian that were in Philadelphia, the church was St. George Methodist Episcopal Church. And this was in the 1600s and 1700s. And the church was growing by leaps and bounds. And one of the reasons that the church was growing by leaps and bounds was because of an African preacher by the name of Richard Allen. And Richard Allen was allowed to preach at the 6 o'clock in the morning service because they thought nobody would be there. But the church continued to grow, and people of both races began to visit there. And so they overgrew the church. In the process of overgrowing the church, they expanded the church. And both black and white were working on that, building the expansion, which included a balcony. So on the day that they were dedicating the balcony, everybody was there. And one of the things about the Methodist Episcopal Church is that we have what we call a chancery rail. And so most AME churches that you go into, they have a chancery rail, and they have an entire kneeling bench, and you come and you kneel. So that day, everyone was coming to kneel. The history had been is that both blacks and whites could come and kneel, but the officers in the church were all white. And so that particular day, when Richard Allen and the other Africans were kneeling, praying, thanking God for the new building and for their concerns, the officers in the church, the white officers, began to pull them up off their knees so that they could get out of the way so that the white members could come and kneel. And one of the things that Richard Allen and Absalom Jones were the two main people in this, they said, "If you just let us finish our prayer, you won't have to be bothered with us anymore." And so they left in a group that day. And when they left that day, they went on to form what was called the Free African Society. And it was basically a 501c3. Where they did things and made sure that everybody had what they needed. You know, kind of like that story is in Acts, you know, when it talks about everybody was of one accord and they met daily praying and the church was increased, you know, that thing. And that's what they did. And in it, they finally have what we have now called the African Methodist Episcopal Church. And I'm a member. I love the history of my church. But one of the things about it was They started because of the injustice of people being, how people were treated. Because we're all one. We're all one. We may have different color skin. But we all pray to the same God. We all want our children to play in the yard without getting shot in the drive-by. We want to be able to go to the grocery store and not be massacred, to pray in our churches and not be shot, as my particular church has experienced in Charlotte. And you remember, Charleston, I mean, and you remember when we lost 9 members in the Sunday school, in Bible study that night. And the gentleman that came in, you know, he went through the Bible study with them. And then as they were praying to end the service, he pulled out his gun and began shooting. But we are all one. And so I will say this, on Friday night at St. Paul AME Church, we had a fish fry. And Darla and Father Todd were there. And we talked about this relationship that we have. And he talked to Father Christian about he wanted to do more with the community. And Father Christian came across the way and found us among the other African-American churches over there. And we've done many things, and many of you have participated. I know several people here because we have done the prayer walks. You know, we do the one for Advent where we walk the community and we pray. We really emphasize on the churches and the schools and the daycares in the area, praying for peace, praying for love, praying for justice. And then in Lent, we have another walk doing the same thing. And then I heard about this thing called Alpha. And my first Alpha was online, and it was phenomenal. And so I couldn't wait till we could do it in person. And so last year, we had Alpha at the 10th Street Community Center in East Stuart. We had it here. They had that one there. That's sacred ground. And then we moved on to there. And then now we're doing Sacred Ground, which I know some of you are members of. And Sacred Ground, I did it last year at the 10th Street Community Center, and it was so profound for me. I went to a historically black college, Tennessee State University in Nashville. So I learned a lot about the history of my people. But still, there was so much more for me to learn. You know, being a little girl from Mississippi, I've seen a lot of things. I saw a lot of things probably that kids shouldn't see. So I knew a lot of things. But I know that people can change. And all you have to do is try. You know, people might not look like you. And it's fear. It's only fear that separates us. It's putting somebody else as the other. They don't look like me, so they can't be like me. But that's not true. We all are made in the image of God. And so I love this church. I love fellowshipping with this church. Father Christian comes and he participates in some of our worship services. He even participates in some of our funerals because of the relationships that we have built. And so I ask you, if you have not come, St. Paul AME Church, the oldest African-American church in Stuart, the church that we're all, anything social justice, we started over there. And so we're doing this. Sacred Ground is a perfect place to be as St. Paul, because St. Paul is all about the only reason Richard Allen and the others left was because of the way they were being treated, how they were not being respected. Otherwise, there would be no need for the African Methodist Episcopal Church. And people have asked us to change our name, but because of who found us and the history behind that, we will never change the name. But everybody is welcome. We have members of all races, all colors, and we love everyone. So please, next time Alpha's coming, come and join Alpha. You'll see me and some others. Next time, it's not even too late now. We only had one Sacred Ground meeting. We're meeting on Wednesday nights at St. Paul AME Church, 900 Southeast East Avenue in Stuart. And you can come and jump in. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend Dr. Charmaine. Thank you, Father Christian. Thank you, Darcy. Thank all of you in Sacred Ground and all of you who reach out in so many ways to express God's reconciling love. We have a long way to go. We're well on our way, and may God continue to lead us in that love. Thank you so much. We want to take a moment to honor our outgoing vestry members with a special gift. Their names are listed there. And that icon you see, if we could go back to that, is exactly what we're going to be giving our vestry members who have served so faithfully. That'd be Ella, Lon, Mark, Tom, and Jeannie. These are icons of the Blessed Virgin Mary and Child, and we'd like you to have this as a way of remembering your service. We're so thankful. Thank you to our staff for arranging these for us and having them delivered just in the nick of time. Who am I missing? Ella. Thank you. Mark. Okay. There we are. Thank you. Thank you all for your service. It's truly appreciated. I'm actually going to begin my remarks with one more gift. It's a recognition gift. It's for Jeannie Dupel, who I think it's fair to say has served incredibly faithfully through three rectorships. And if you look at the screen, you can see something we've made for her. It's a custom-made, what we're going to call the St. Mary's Cross, of sterling silver. Jeannie, can we present this to you? Can you come up? Yes. Maybe Julie could help you put it on and you could show it to us. Here, we'll get this open. Father Christian, can you come up with a photo too?
I gotta speak after this.
You gotta speak after this. Okay. Let's aim that at the camera. We'll put Father Christian on the other side. Some people would say this is the Purple Heart, depending on how the days were going over these last many years. All right. Thank you.
We love you, Jeannie.
Thank you.
Couldn't have done this without you. You're the best boss. Oh, no, don't forget the good news.
Jeannie, you served through three different rectors. You and the others have guided this church so beautifully. Father Christian, serving as our interim rector, bringing us to this moment now. The last 6 months have continued to be an incredible experience for Tara and myself and our family as we've beheld the glory of God in your very faces as the light of Jesus continues to shine through you, and we're grateful to be with you. The best is yet to come, I believe, in this season, this new season, as together we love and serve the Lord. As I was thinking about what I would say this morning and praying about it, I was brought to this image of the life of Moses, who, after 40 years of leading the people through the wilderness, through good times and bad times, many challenging times, Moses gets to Mount Nebo, this high point where the writer of Deuteronomy tells us that Moses looked over the promised land in its entirety all the way to the Mediterranean Sea. And what's unusual about that scripture is that you cannot see the Mediterranean Sea from that point. Some of us have stood there. It's out there, but you can't see it with your own eyes. And perhaps that's the author's point, that Moses was seeing by faith what he believed to be out there, that God was giving him a vision even beyond what his human mind could understand, much like the Apostle Paul, who said, "We see through a dark glass dimly, but one day we will see face to face, and we will know just as we are fully known," which means that you are so loved by God so precious in his sight that God wants to give you a vision of how loved you are and how much God loves this world and how God wants to give us vision beyond what we can see with our human eyes to something greater, something beyond. And that vision is very much at work in this church, and it's a joy to behold that vision with you. So I've preached a lot this morning. I'm not going to preach another sermon. I'm simply going to say thank you so much for your faithfulness. Thank you for your warm welcome of us. And thank you for your love, which endures forever. Amen. As I've said, I'm so thankful to be part of this gifted staff. And without any further ado, I'm going to invite up our Vicar of Operations, Father Christian.
Hello, everyone. So you have the report, and my report's in there. So I just want to say, in this new position, I am excited to grow into this new development where a lot of the focus I've been doing is more outreach focused and drumming up and lifting up teams for what it look like for us to be a missional church of constantly being put outside our comfort zone. And that's where we find Jesus. We find Jesus. We do a lot of inreach, which builds us up as disciples, and then we go out to experience discipleship by just giving it all away through the generous hearts of Christ. And so you probably won't feel as much of the new position for myself. It's probably more internal. So really what just changes a lot is that I see a lot more of my computer screen, and it's a lot more administration. but if there's other questions you have, if you remember where Tom's position was before as the director of operations, so we have found historically throughout the church that the position of a parish administrator, which then also was magnified when Tom came in to director of operations, is a huge position that leads to burnout. And it's not a healthy position for a church. And I don't know if you've seen this in other churches you've been a part of, that the parish administrator is usually way overworked and always just like one email away from burnout. And there's so many responsibilities that fall under that one person. And so what we've experimented with here is that in a new way of looking at the organization of the church, of this church, is what if you deconstruct that role? And so you deconstruct that role, so you're going to have these different directors. You have a director of administration, which is Ashley. You have a director of finance, which is Tom. So he focuses on money, which is a full-time position. You have a director of facilities, which is Justin. He's not a sexton. He's a director of facilities. Now, he overlooks the sextons. But he does all the stuff where he's working with all our vendors, with our events. As you know, this campus, we have maximized out as much as we can rent it out. We have a school that's alive here on campus that continues to grow, and we have a great relationship with them. We have events, as you know, quinceañeras and weddings that we are finding that balance of the income it brings in, but also the toil and struggle that it brings to the rest of this campus as well, and I think we're finding a nice balance with that. And then we have other directors of youth, of course, director of music and worship. So then above that, what you'll see is just, then I will be the quarterback to be with and walk with all those directors and then have the vision of Father Joe, who is the visioner. He's the one who applies the vision and the mission for the church. And then it's my responsibility to how to communicate that well to all and be in contact with all the directors. So we now can have a leader who can focus on all the big stuff, and that's Father Joe. He can focus on vision. He loves pastoral care, as you know, of just being out there with the people on the mission of the church. And then also, as he said today, making sure that this church is here 50 years ahead of us and beyond, and making sure that we're building up this endowment fund. So the church of, because now we want to be thinking about the church of tomorrow. We want to be thinking of the Kwamis and Kwekus, my children, that there is a church, there's a St. Mary's for them. Because we don't know what the future is going to look like. But we can make sure that we've been responsible enough to raise up an endowment that allows St. Mary's to continue to serve here for the years to come. So that's the position I'll be in, and which means I might probably have to step back a little bit from some of the other stuff, but I think we're at a place now where the laity here, and friends, and I've asked Father Joe this, and I said, you know, we're really blessed with strong laity. Is that normal? And he's like, no. just usually you see, 5% of the people doing 95% of the work. But you guys are just so gaga for Jesus, and you found a home here at St. Mary's. That's the big reason why this place is on fire, is because you're on fire. And so then that makes this part of the job as well, because now it's just working with you all as leaders of formation, leaders of work, working with Jerry, with all the outreach and the wonderful team. So just thank you for being so awesome and loving this church and continuing to lift up this church. And I can't wait to continue to be leaders who make leaders. That's what we do. We are leaders who make leaders. And if not, if we're not disciples who are making more disciples, as Kenda Dean once said, that we're just mules. We're not reproducing Christians. We talk about Jesus, but we're not lifting up more Jesus followers. So let's keep on lifting up more Jesus followers. All this organization chart, which I can show you at any time, all it does is just mean, how do we lift up more disciples who follow Jesus Christ and help change this world to a place of love? So I'm excited to do that this next year with you. Amen.
Thank you, Father Christian. And now, Rector's Ward Report, Jeannie Dupel. This is your final moment for now. For now.
Okay, wow, okay. Although 2023 began in a period of transition, the year ended in a new season with the call of Father Joe to be our rector in his installation in August. I want to give a special thank you to the search committee, led by Maureen Cotter. The committee spent countless hours in prayer and meetings. And in addition to the search committee, the vestry assumed a lot of additional responsibilities, and I'm grateful to all of them for their hard work and dedication. And of course, thank you also to the clergy and staff. During this time, unlike most churches during the transition, we continued to grow. I'd love to share where I see St. Mary's in this new season. I see outstanding leadership. We have a superstar team of Father Joe and Father Christian as our spiritual leaders. Their vision for St. Mary's is inspiring, and their sermons are exceptional. I can't tell you how many times people come up to me and say, "We are so blessed," and we are. I see enthusiastic laity. There's so many parishioners who give tirelessly to support our ministries. And the vestry, again, this year hosted a ministry fair to gain awareness of the ministries and ways to get involved. I see a music ministry that reaches outside the walls of St. Mary's to bring community members to our church. I see a vibrant youth ministry to middle schoolers and high schoolers and a growing Sunday school. I see growth in membership with over 100 new members in 2023. I see a continued commitment and enthusiasm for outreach. We reach out to the community right here on campus and beyond. I see a renewed commitment to interfaith work. The attendance at the Breaking Bread series this past fall was the highest yet, and there's a desire to keep this momentum going. And finally, I see a community who's not interested in the status quo. We're always looking for new ways to grow into Jesus and reach out with love. And on a personal note, Father Todd, a little over 3 years ago, asked me to be his, much to my surprise, asked me to be his rector's warden. And after he retired, I served under Father Christian and during the transition and for Father Joe since his arrival. And as warden, I have been privileged to have a firsthand look at how clergy, staff, and laity all work together to make St. Mary's such a special place. It's been my honor to serve in this role. I've learned a lot about myself, formed valued friendships, and have certainly grown spiritually. I've done my best to serve St. Mary's, a place that I genuinely love, and I look forward with excitement to 2024.
Thank you. Now we'll hear from Tom Winter, Director of Finance.
Good morning, everyone. I really tried to get out of this year, but Christian said no. He said everyone hears from the clergy all the time, and they want to hear from you. I didn't really believe him, but I went along with it anyway. So who is this guy up here? I see him. We see him around campus, always looking a little grumpy. George Costanza once said, if you want people to think you're busy, look annoyed. But I'm really usually not annoyed. I'm usually focused, so lots of stuff to do. So I've been a volunteer here now, or a member of St. Mary's for 15, 16 years. I've been on the vestry. I served as CFW liaison for many years and CFW champion after that to keep it going. I was on the finance committee, the prior rector search committee, the bishop search team, which was a very interesting experience. So I've seen a lot, but primarily my function is behind the scenes work. Work to provide the infrastructure and the support and all the back end business work that goes into any organization. So I'm usually behind the scenes, but I'm happy to come out in front and speak and answer questions, and I'm always available for anything at any time that you want to talk about. Happy to do that. So it is a new season with the arrival of King Arthur, and he happened to bring along Father Joe, our new rector. That was wonderful. We have a new focus on stewardship and long-term church strategy, which I'm very excited about. And our goal really to have a greater impact upon you as individuals, your families, and the communities at large. It's big. That's why we're here, right? Impact. We've also done a lot of talking and strategizing about team workflow changes, which Father Christian talked about during his little talk there. So we're all very proud of that. People ask, well, why do you want to keep growing as a church? Well, a little bit of growth is healthy. Too much growth can be unhealthy, whether it's in your community or in your church. But we want to grow. Why? For impact, right? We want to have more impact upon our lives and each other and continue to find a safe place for people to gather, worship, and feel comfortable. It's economically healthy. It brings us economies of scale. But we've also found what worked for us as a smaller church doesn't really work now as a larger church. We still have old habits that we're trying to reinvent and look forward to. But there comes a time in any organization where you can operate as a mom and pop or a small entity, and it's all fine, but then all of a sudden it's not, because you cross this threshold of workflow and balance, and that requires a completely new strategy. I've seen that in many organizations, including St. Mary's. We've crossed that threshold of a medium-sized church that really we're now on the heels of that class five church, that larger church. So it's really invited us to reflect upon how we do things and what it looks like for the future. We do have challenges, of course. Resources always hold organizations back, and it holds us back in some ways. We talk more about money than we have in the past. We need both short-term operating cash, and we need to build our long-term endowment. We have serious rising cost of labor and other operating costs. Our volunteer force has kind of come forward now and out of the COVID hiatus, but now we're starting to talk about, well, how do we use our volunteers in the most efficient manner? We have plenty, but how do we utilize that? So that's the topic of strategy right now. And our challenge now is our campus is more or less running at capacity. We went from COVID zero to 2023, 110%, that we had to kind of dial it back a little bit because we were almost overutilized. So we have a huge campus, but we utilize it at 100% pretty much. This slide made a big hit last year at the annual meeting where I brought up the point where our giving, our offerings have not kept up with our growth and our expenses. We've had to close that delta through other sources of revenue, serious campus utilization, special appeals sometimes, government funding. So our challenge short term is we got to stop this. We got to close that delta and make sure that the giving of the church matches our growth and our expenses. One of the ways that we raised a lot of money over the last few years is campus rental and use income. But what you see here is a sharp growth post-COVID, but I think we plateaued. I don't think we can grow that anymore. Now, we can mess with the elasticity of the demand and maybe increase the fees a little bit more, but I think we're right at the point where we charge much more and then our demand is going to drop. So we kind of live on this curve here of trying to use the campus as most efficiently as we can, but I think we're reaching the point where we're kind of tapped out. Accounted, a lot of the work we do at St. Mary's is somewhat intangible, right? So a lot of things go on that most people don't know about. We touch people, we help people. We do so many things that the greater church doesn't know about. But one measure of activity in the church can be how much money flows in and out. So we sometimes shy away from talking about money, but we need to because, as I like to say, if there's no money, there's no mission. We need money to operate the campus and the operation and keep things going. But if you look at one measure that's very tangible, you take in inflows plus outflows, and you can see the sharp growth of all transactions within St. Mary's. Back in 2012, I always like to look back, we handled $2.3 million of transactions, up to 3.2, 4.2, now we're at about $5 million of inflows and outflows at St. Mary's. All that is a pretty good indicator of what kind of activity is going on at St. Mary's. So that's a significant jump over the last few years. I talked about this before, where change of strategy with church growth and size. Smaller churches are typically pastor-driven. Pastor says, let's do this, and the team executes it. When you get larger, things kind of spin up and take on lives of their own. So Father Joe and we all trying to broaden that scope of responsibility among the whole team so we can handle things and handle projects in a little bit more efficient manner rather than it all flow through either Father Joe or myself or Father Christian. So I like to say St. Mary's is a larger church now, kind of stuck in a smaller church body. And we need to continue to move out of that. So Father Christian alluded to my role has changed. So I've now broken up my job into three distinct parts. Justin is handling facilities. Ashley handles all the office operations. And I've still maintained my handle on finance, accounting, AT, AV, IT, AV, and whatever else needs to be done. I'll call myself a generalist. So we have less reliance upon one person and more reliance upon the team, and we're all cross-functional. So this is what we look like. I put us all inside of one big bubble because we can all cover for each other, we all look out for each other, we're all there for each other, and we're one big team to help serve St. Mary's in the most efficient manner possible. It's not my job, it's not in our vocabulary. People like to talk about outreach. That's steadily grown over the years. Last year, 23, was a huge year, almost $300,000, and a lot of that was because of the great program that Reverend Patsy put on, which accounted for about $164,000 of revenue. So we continue to reach outside the walls of this church and make an impact. My favorite book when I first started here was The Coming Revolution in Church Economics, and I referenced this last year, and I'll say again, tithes and offerings are not enough. We need to find alternative sources of revenue, which we've talked about. We've had overall patterns in the church beyond us is people marginally are increasing their gift to churches. That's kind of a trend. We do need to continue our multiple streams of income to fund things around here, right? And we have to struggle with the rising costs. But overall, we need to bless the community with good work. So what can we do? People say that, what can I do? Well, we need to grow our endowment to $10 million. I talked about that at the last annual meeting. We're currently at $1 million. We need to grow our reserve funds to $1 million. Last year, we were at $250,000. We've been able to grow that to $500,000. We need to raise awareness of what it takes to operate St. Mary's to everyone. I think we've done that over the last 2 years. I think people are more aware of what goes on here. We need to continue the alternative sources of revenue, the operating cash. This stewardship season, the 24 stewardship campaign, I think has been a great success, and we've achieved the majority of our objectives. And we need to continue, above all, to do great work. So our call to excellence starts with the staff. We want to continue to do smart, efficient programming. Just because we did it last year doesn't necessarily mean we'll do it this year. We do our work with competence, grace, and love. We promise to do our best to walk in a manner worthy of God. And of course, conduct St. Mary's work in a way that aligns with Jesus' own character. We fail all the time. I fail all the time, right? We're human. We're humans operating at St. Mary's, and we do our best. But that's our call to excellence. We've talked about this last year. We anticipate, try to plan and think ahead, balance the workload with our leadership among staff. We trust in each other, and we own our projects, and we own our departments. So what am I proud of last year? I always like to talk about it. Well, we went 1.5 years without a rector, right? How cool is that? The bishop said, you guys are good enough. Christian can step up. Your leadership is strong. Go for it. I think we were successful, and Father Joe stepped into a church that was well-balanced, well-managed. So I think that's a great accomplishment. Jeannie, you really took it on the chin. I call that the St. Mary's Purple Heart Award for surviving that. We promise you we will continue to grow and develop as a staff with everything that we do here at St. Mary's, and we'll continue to create a safe place to grow in God's love. So I just want, I'd like to recognize the staff. They're not all here. Ashley, you're in the back. I see you hiding. Stand up, Ashley. She's a big part of what we do here. Justin, he's not here. Kate the Great, are you here? Kate? Wiston's not here today. Derek's in the back. Melinda, Digital Mally, as we call her. Eve Warren, our community care coordinator. She does fantastic work behind the scenes. You know me now. Robert, our thrift store proprietor and number one horse trader. So thank you so much. We can have a question and answer session after Mr. Bish. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Tom. We appreciate so much your diligent hard work. So much of it is not even seen, but we've just gotten a glimpse of the incredible work Tom does. All right, we will now move to our treasurer, another equally hardworking individual, Bob Bish.
Good morning, all. You have the annual report, but it's in awfully small print. So if you haven't looked at it closely, I'm sympathetic. But we finished 2023 with a net revenue of $323,000. And that sounds pretty good. But that's not the whole story. As Tom points out, over the past 10 years, our revenues from plate and pledge have not kept pace with our growing church. Through this period, we balanced the budget each year, but with the help of federal funding under the CARES Act during COVID, unrestricted bequests that weren't planned, the rental and other income that Tom alluded to. So last May, when we were close to making a decision to call a new rector, we realized that we might come up short. So we agreed that a special appeal was necessary in order to assure that we could keep the church on a sound financial footing for our new rector. And a small group of parishioners helped us raise $245,000. A summary of our of the finances is in the annual report for the first time in a long time, I might mention. But as Tom pointed out, we've got operating and cash reserves now of a little over $500,000. And while our endowed funds are at $1.1 million, we're already well on our way to increase that to hopefully $10 million over 10 years, is it, Father Joe? Maybe sooner. As Tom pointed out, we continue to reach out into the community with financial support for mission and outreach. And the number that I have for what we posted last year is $256,000, but I'm not going to quarrel with Tom on that score. The outlook for 2024 is very positive. Father Joe came in, looked at who we are and where we stood, and said we need to figure out how to raise the plate, the pledge, and other offerings, and ask the parish for 20% increase. And we are almost there. And what that really means from my perspective is that we won't need to rely on other special income in order to balance the budget soundly for 2024. And we hope that the vestry will approve a balanced budget at its next meeting. For the record, our outside auditor has approved our 2022 financial statement as being a satisfactory report. The treasurer tries to report quarterly on how we're doing, but financial statements are available either through me or in the office if you'd like more detail. And I think that's it. And thank you very much for your attention.
For all that you do. And Beth, thank you for sharing him with us. I can't imagine how many late nights he's working, crunching those numbers. Thank you. We now have a time for open questions, and I'll just preface that by adding to what Bob and Tom have said about our finances. First of all, thank you very much for your faithfulness and your generosity. We have had a very wonderful pledge campaign. It's still ongoing. I want to remind you of that. It's not over yet. There are still many outstanding pledges, so we look forward to seeing those come in so we can all bring them together. But having said that, we are well on our way toward an increased level of generosity. We're very thankful for that. I'm also grateful to share with you that we've had a family approach us and indicate that they're going to give $1 million to our endowment in stages starting now, not sometime way off in the future. So that takes us over $2 million in theory. So thanks be to God. God is faithful, he provides, and he does it through the generous hearts of his people. So thank you all. Let's now transition to open questions. There's a microphone here, which I encourage you to stand up to, and that way we can all hear you. So Candace, did you want to say something?
Could you just talk a little bit about the endowment? How do you see it being used? How do you see it being protected in the future?
Thank you. Candace asks about the endowment. How do we see it being used? How do we see it being protected in the future? Well, it's known as the Heritage Fund, and the goal is $10 million in 10 years, so it can produce an operating income for us to sustain our operations. If you take 4%, that's $400,000. Ideally, that would be great. Who knows what things will look like 10 years from now, but we think that's what we need. It's under very careful management and attention, and I have every confidence that it will be protected as opposed to being raided. So we want to preserve it and build it up and find revenue streams from other sources, and that's what we're committed to doing. Thank you, great question. Any other questions or comments?
Hello, my name is Dr. Blanche Wells, and I'm a new member here, and I can't say enough about how happy my husband and I, how blessed we feel to be here. My question is, Tom Winter mentioned that we have to look at other ways of raising money other than the usual ways that churches do. Have we thought of any of those ways yet?
I can certainly let Tom speak to that, but what I can say is, in addition to aggressive rental agreements and asking for tithes and offerings from the congregation, we do not yet have any vision for raising money in any other exceptional way, but I'll let Tom speak to that.
There, our options are somewhat limited. Using the campus assets is a big way, but I think we're leveling off with that right now. We don't have too much growth in there. There's various ways, but at this point, giving needs to match church growth because our alternative sources are limited. I even rent out parking spaces here during the week to raise money. I rent out Father Christian's office when he's not in there. But going forward, we need to close that delta that I showed on that graph of giving not matching growth. We don't make widgets here, right? We can't increase output. We can't raise our prices. It's strange this organization relies on donations. How scary is that, right? So we need to make sure you all feel good about your giving to St. Mary's and that we're filling your hearts. So, but we're running low on alternative sources of revenue. We're looking to replace some of the windows in the office and around the church. Our facilities committee is looking at grants and money to help us with that. So basically, right now it needs to be focused on giving. Did I answer the question? Yeah, you're welcome. Who else has got a question?
I don't know if it's a question as much as an idea to help raise more money. A few things. One, especially being a busy mom, sometimes I don't get to even make it to the end of the service where you pledge. If you guys had a box or, you know, a locked donation box just in the back that people that maybe missed it or couldn't get it fast enough, you know, out of their purse, it could help increase collections. Also, sometimes you just want to drop it in right when you walk in so you don't have to think about it for the rest of the service. So that might be able to help, especially young families. Another thing, since you guys have this beautiful kitchen, and busy working moms would love to pick up a meal. If that was something that you guys could add, I know that there are tons of moms around this town that would gladly pay 20, 30 bucks to pick up a to-go meal. It doesn't even have to be cooked. We can throw it in our oven. So those are two ways that I've thought of that could help increase your revenue.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Barry Stalker, for those that don't know me. I have a special request. It's not just coming from an old person that...
Your hair looks great.
My memory is becoming less reliable, and like a lot of other people of my age, it becomes more difficult to associate names and faces. I'd like to make a special request that the vestry consider commissioning a new directory? The current one is almost 10 years out of date. Currently, it probably only covers about 30% of the people that are here, and we have no idea about so many of the new people that have joined us, especially in the last year. It is a wonderful tool, especially for me, to look at, to know who we need to pray for, and to remind me of the names that I've forgotten or can't associate. So please consider that commission. It can be done at no cost to the church, and it has been done that way in the past. So please consider it.
Thank you. Father Christian has a comment behind you, I believe. Yeah.
Sure.
My fellow man of hair, yours has grown back very quickly. We're going to do another drive again, raise money. So any time you want the new directory, just please come to the office. This is what I'm hearing, is that we need to do a better job of communicating this, of getting, so there's a directory that gets updated continuously. Of course, it's our Purple Heart winner, Jeannie, who is every week updating that directory. So you can always come in, and we can either email you a PDF if you want to go green, or print it out for you. Now, for the pictures, you'll notice a lot of pictures are missing. However, it's because many of you don't wish to have your picture in there. So we've tried, and we've provided photographers. So how about this? So if you don't wish to have your, you can send us any picture. You can send us a picture from when you were 19. It's fine. Because people say, I don't want that picture in there, because I like the picture from 30 years ago. That's fine. Give us that. I think that will help. So if we could do that, just know that the church has definitely heard that. And we can do that again, have another round of photographers. We usually put them in, like, in the courtyard and say, get your picture. I think Sal did the last round. But you can always email to us at the office, and we can actually start. Actually, you and I will talk about this, the most effective way to do that. If you want to email us an updated photo so we can have a picture, because I totally agree with you, and it really helps with building the community. So thank you for that comment. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mary Shaw has a comment. I want to say one thing. We have a new church management system as of last year. And this year we want to make it and encourage everyone to sign up. So you create an account, it enables St. Mary's to communicate, and eventually it will lead to a robust online database of everyone if people sign up. But if people don't sign up, then it's just going to be awkward. So, Mary.
Thank you. I'm Mary Shaw, and I had the privilege of serving on the search committee, and we're very happy to have Father Joe with us. But what I want to say today is what a wonderful job Christian did during that time. I was involved in the last search committee before this one as well, and we had an interim come in for 2 years, which gave us a cushion. This time we didn't know how much a cushion we had because we didn't have the interim, but we felt confident as things were not moving along as quickly that we were in good hands, and I thank you, Christian. Also, Dale Hudson has reminded me about the directory, and another way for us to get to know each other is through wearing our name tags. I know it's easy to put them in the car and forget to put them on. I do it myself. But like Barry, my memory is not what it used to be, so please wear your name tags.
I don't think I have an original thought in my head, but I wanted to just, I had spoken to Father Christian about this back. I was with a health system on the west coast of Florida, and we did a program called Catch the Wave, Waste Annihilated, Value Enhanced. And if there's a way that we could encourage all of us, you know, when you see, a light on, or there's some things that we can do that can reduce the cost of our our electricity, our utilities, and some things. Maybe it's something that we can take a look at campus-wide and carve a little bit off of our budget. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Hi. My name is Paul Hamady. I have a kind of a follow-up question from the town hall. We've talked about finances. You've talked about the operating budget, the gap we need to close absolutely through giving pledges, et cetera. But what about, while we're still talking about finances, some resurrection of the facilities master plan? Because we know there are things, as Tom mentioned, the windows in the church. There are other things around campus. And I think it would be beneficial for the people. I'm not advocating a campaign or anything, so don't hiss at me. I'm just thinking if we had to see a more complete picture of what we need for not only an operating budget, but also for capital funds and what we want to do with this campus, because there are some things left over from this renovation and pre-COVID that we haven't gotten around to yet. So I think a full master plan of both the expense and the capital budgets or capital side wish list would be very beneficial for us. And maybe that's already in existence.
Thank you, Paul. Lon.
Hi, Lon King. In regard to Paul's question, Christine Fecko is heading up that committee and had two meetings so far, and they're starting to look towards the future.
Thank you.
I just had something to add to that. So there's so many people that don't necessarily have funds to give, but they have talents and own businesses, and there's probably someone that owns a window business in this congregation. So if we had a list of everything that was needed, we don't necessarily need to go pay for it. We can find people within our congregation that can help through service too.
Thank you.
So I'll introduce myself. I'm Kristen Fecko, and I'm the vestry liaison to facilities. So we're restarting the facilities committee. We would love to have anybody join us. We're meeting once every 2 months. Generally the last Thursday of the month, although it will fall on Easter. So the next time we will meet will be March 21st at 5:30. We meet in Youth Room 1. Anybody that's interested, please join us. We are starting with looking at our energy efficiencies, getting a survey from FPL, and we do need to replace some windows primarily in Smith Hall and the church office because they're old and not very efficient. So we have looked into grants, so far have not been successful, but we're continuing to gather up the heels of the old campaign, those last details, and figure out how we can be more efficient with our energy use and see how we go from here and how we can best support Justin and the Sextons. So please join us. My email, it's not printed anywhere. My name is with the vestry, and my email is just my full name at gmail.com. So if you have any interest or you want to be on the committee, please reach out. I'd really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Linda Cabral. Some of you may recognize me from the usher, being an usher here, and also from the healing service. I've heard a lot of talk about name badges and not recognizing people. I just wanted to let everybody know that out in the front desk of the CFW service, there are name badges that you can print and stick on your shirt. So if you want to do that, if you're waiting for your name badge, or you don't have a name badge, or you bring a guest with you, have them fill out a name tag and wear it. And so we all know who you are, so we can all welcome you to this wonderful community. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kathy Hurlbert. Father Christian might not remember this. About 2 years ago, he walked me back to the Memorial Garden. I didn't even know it was there. And showed it to me. And not long after that, I went to the office and asked about it. And we did purchase one of the niches in there. I don't think you talk enough about that and how many are still for sale to fill in. There's a lot of no names on them. And I don't think a lot of us have a lot of information on them. I spoke to a friend and was telling her about it, and she's now planning to come. She's a church member, and buy her space. So that's another way of revenue that I don't think has been tapped on.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And we're thankful to Kate in the office who manages that information and welcomes people in with questions, and we'll sit down with people often and have that very sensitive, tender conversation about final remains, and whether it be for your loved ones or your family, she's wonderful for that. So Kate, thank you for that. You know, I love the sense of freedom and transparency we're all experiencing. That's very much a part of the administration I want to lead, and it's already happened with the town hall, and this morning is no exception. So keep the questions coming. I've always said my heart and my door is open to you. I really mean that. I'll listen. If you have thoughts and questions, comments, yes, even criticisms, bring them. We want to know each other. We want to seek God's truth together, and that's how we do it, with full and open communication. So thank you very much. Do we have any other comments or reflections you'd like to make before we move to a closing prayer, and then the doxology, and then the adjournment?
I know he's not here today, but I think we have a treasure in Brandon Glick.
You're here.
He has brought great music to not only our wonderful church, but to our community. We no longer have to leave Martin County to hear word class concerts.
Thank you. Before moving to the closing song known as the doxology, I want to offer a special prayer, again from the Book of Common Prayer. And the Lord really put this on my heart during Charmaine's reflections. It's called the Prayer for the Human Family. Let us join our hearts together in God's love and pray. As we say, O God, you made us in your own image and redeemed us through Jesus, your Son. Look with compassion on the whole human family. Take away the arrogance and hatred which infect our hearts. Break down the walls that separate us. Unite us in bonds of love, and work through our struggle and confusion to accomplish your purposes on earth, that in your good time, all nations and races may serve you in harmony around your heavenly throne through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
If you'd please stand. We have not designated a leader to lead us in the doxology. I wonder if I could call upon Paul Hamady to lead us. Okay.
Sing it, Paul.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thank you. May we please have a motion to adjourn? Second. All those in favor? Opposed? So adjourned. Thank you all very much.